Hello everyone and welcome to the latest episode of Round Ball Rules, where we sit around the table and chat all things A-League men's. It's only going to be a short episode today because there's not much to talk about, isn't it? Just a joke. Isn't that right, gentlemen? I'm joined by Daniel McBreen and Tristan McManus for today's show. Plenty on the table, gentlemen, isn't there?
Where do you even start?
Oh, well, I know. I don't think we're going to have time, really.
The good thing about doing a vodcast podcast show like this is there's no time limit, so we may well be here. Might have to go from here straight to Friday's game between Victory and the Jets. Fine. If so be it, there's lots to unpack. We're going to start with one of the big talking points. Now, there was Luis Figo from Barcelona to Real Madrid, of course. Emmanuel Adebayor, who went from North London club Arsenal to Tottenham. Fabrice Fiorez, who left PSG for Marseille. Okay, that's a personal one. Yeah. And Ninkovic, of course, from Sydney FC to Western Sydney. But now, Bruno Fornaroli has gone from Perth to Melbourne Victory. 35 years of age, Socceroo, 2 international caps. Tristan, are you surprised by this move?
Yeah, I am 100%. I didn't see it coming at all. I mean, obviously, he was such an integral part for the first 2 games of the season for Perth. I was hoping I was going to get the inside scoop from you guys about what's going on, because I don't know everything about the league over here, but I did hear about a salary cap. So I'm trying to get my head around how that move actually managed to happen. So, I don't know.
He's actually gone for an injury replacement. So yeah, that's how they got around that. So if someone's out injured long term, you can bring another player in. The fact that
there are still transfer windows where you can register players, and they are still based on the same months and timings as European League. So the next one's January, the January transfer window. But if you have an injury replacement, you can bring in a player on contract. So Matthew Sporanovic is the player.
Well, this is the contentious moment. Sporanovic is a centre back. It used to be like for like. So if you had a centre back, you could bring a defender in. Now it just seems that that rule's gone out the window, and if you've got an injured player, you can bring another one in, and I think it's a bit of a loophole. I don't really agree with it, to be honest, in my opinion, but it is what it is, and they've played by the rules, and they've got another attacker in that plethora of attackers they've got, so he's the answer for them to fix that goal-scoring woes, potentially. He's got a great record.
They haven't scored in their last 3 victory. Yeah. They scored 3 in that first game, but haven't scored in their last 3. But is he even fit and ready to go? I know he says he's fit, but we've heard that there were ankle injuries that scuppered his pre-season since basically the matches with the Socceroos. He's 35 years of age. He has a fantastic scoring record, no doubt. I've got the stats here. 48 in 70. For Melbourne City before, and he had an injury there, ankle injury, and then had that falling out with the coach Joyce. And then Perth, 34 in 72. So he's basically averaging 1 in 2 in the Australian League with the A-League men. But he's only won 1 cup. And this brings it back to the fact that you can bring in a star striker who scores you lots of goals. Not enough goals to win the league yet. Now, I know he was a fantastic striker, but this is a team sport. It didn't work out in Perth. Now he's coming to Victory. You've already got Nick D'Agostino, who's a Socceroo. You've got Tommy Urich, who's a Socceroo up front. Where are you going? How many goals are we expecting him to score now? And does this upset the apple cart a little bit?
Well, depending on what was behind the move, of course. Look, there's no doubt it's a great move anyway. I mean, you're going to want to play for a team that has someone like Nani on one wing for sure. I mean, would you put him in over Tommy Urich? I would. You know, there's no doubt he's going to get goals now. The only one who can say, he would have had to pass a medical to get into there. So he's saying he's fit. They're, on the looks of it, saying that he's fit as well. Whatever's happened at Perth, I mean, it's in the past now, isn't it? I have no doubt he's going to score goals. No doubt.
Macca.
We'll see. Yeah. Yes, go on. Go.
Well, I was just going to say, we always spoke about when Popper goes to a new club, he brings in the players he likes and the players, it's Melbourne Victory, but it's almost Popper FC in some respects. Yeah. I mean, Paul Izzo is the latest to come back and join in from Santi. He took Fornaroli, or he jumped on Fornaroli when he was available and took him to Perth.
Yeah.
Now he's bringing him here. He knows him. Popper gets the best out of these players. What is the potential?
I look at the upsetting the apple cart. Yeah. You know, D'Agostino had his best season last year. He gets called into the Socceroos. Doing well, okay, scored a great goal in the first one. Okay, well, they haven't scored in 3 games. I don't think that's through, you know, they've created lots of chances, and sometimes you go through these patches, but I sort of look at it and go, where does he fit in? with the way they play. They've got flying wingers on both sides. They've got D'Agostino, who's also a bustling player, who's good in that, strong, good in the air, quite good in the box. He's more of a box player for me. Hold the ball up, get in the box. He hasn't got pace, okay? So if they're going to counter-attack and go quickly with those wingers, is he going to be in the box? Is he going to be able to get there?
Arriving late,
yeah.
Cutbacks.
Yeah, well, yeah, but that's, these are all the questions you've got to ask, and how does he actually fit into that style of play? So it'll be an interesting one, but it's off the back of his second falling out. His last two clubs, he's fallen out. Like, we all saw how that all came out on social media, of all ways. You know, obviously something wasn't right there when he said, "Oh, I'm injured." Well, this is what has came out since, that said he said he was injured and couldn't travel. Then they put that out there, and he said, "No, I'm fit." And then they said, so they've obviously come to, well, we're not on the same path, so let's go the other ways. But you know, that sort of thing as well. Like, what effect will he have in the change room? Is he, if it's not working for him there, does it all blow up again? I don't know. I just find, I'm not shocked by the move, but I'm not sure if it for victory overall. You know, we could be proven wrong here, but I don't know if it's the right fit. I'm not sure.
Yeah, if you haven't scored a goal yet, though, and he's available, you're going to take him. There's so many teams in the league who would have taken him. And as silly as it sounds, I actually think it's a good move for Perth. Because if you've got a player there who doesn't want to be there, you might as well get rid. And they're going to have to play a different way as well. You know, I did Perth's very first game, and I thought if they didn't go through Bruno, if Bruno wasn't doing it, and Perth weren't doing it. And I think it's a good move for them.
Yeah.
Yeah, look, if Perth are happy, Bruno's happy, Melbourne Victory are happy. I don't know if other clubs in the league are feeling that they could have had a chance or should have tried to get in there quicker to get Bruno's services. But look, everyone's happy at the end of the day. One question, we know that talking about all those wingers, well, not really a question, I'll make a comment. They've got all those wingers. They do have D'Agostino and Tommy Urich, but Tommy Urich has had plenty of injury problems as well. Is there a backup striker there? Maybe Daggers is number one still. Fornaroli comes in and you know, he's got big shoulders. He's a big player, but Victory are a big club. Mm-hmm. They've got, and you know, maybe he'll come in a little bit cap in hand and say, here I am now at the service of this club to play second fiddle to D'Agostino. Let's have a look at, so Victory up against the Jets Friday night as well. In theory, Fornaroli is ready to go as well. Mm-hmm. Moving on, let's have a look back at the action from the weekend, and starting with the Mariners against Western United. Western United flying into a 2-goal lead, and then all change at halftime, and the Mariners came storming back into it. But Macca, what did you make of this one? We've been waiting for Western to do their Western thing.
Yeah.
And this was it, against the run of play. Stunning goal from Connor Payne.
Mariners looked the better team. They had created the better opportunities. They had all the play. And this is what we said last year a lot against for Western United. But they scored their two goals, did what they did. And then this was a huge turning point in the game. And, you know, that's a bad challenge, okay?
It looks worse and worse.
It does look worse when you see it in replay. He got a yellow card originally, and we're going to get on to referees later, but anyway, look, I think most people were happy with the yellow card, but then when you look back at it, you can see why it was a red card. Look, it's a studs tackle, in that really just changed the whole game. Western United capitulated. You know, we know they're so resolute in defence, they have been for so long, they're such a good defensive unit. They just went to water, and the Mariners just turned the screws and went through them like a hot knife through butter. And the main protagonists were Cummings and Quoll. Like, Quoll came on at half time. He's starting to get more and more minutes under his belt. He came on, he still looks like a kid who's out in the park playing with his mates who, I don't care, you know, I'm just enjoying it, I'm doing what I want, I'll take people on. He's creating things, and we know he's got that confidence and slight arrogance about him that says, I don't care who I'm playing, I'm just going to do what I do. And it works, and I love watching him play. And Cummings as well, forming quite a little duo there. Those two seem to be pushing very hard claims for that Socceroos trip to the World Cup.
Well, yes, that's the point, isn't it, Tristan? I mean, it's hard to avoid this chat at the moment after every round. There's only one round of matches left now before the 26 will be announced. Garang Quoll, there are lots of people calling for his inclusion. We've just heard that Martin Boyle has injured his knee as well. Let's hope that's not too bad, because Martin Boyle, for me, was rusted on right-sided attacker.
Well, for me, Quoll's rusted on. This is a young
player. He's that same position. Marco Tilio is that same position.
I think he's rusted on to go.
We're not talking the left side here, Macca.
he's a player with his age, his confidence. where he's just signed, where he's going, as for us as a nation and Socceroos going forward. Think about Theo Walcott years ago when they took him to the World Cup. He hadn't played a minute in the Premier League and everyone was like, what are you doing? This is, he's our player like that. He is going to have, if he's managed correctly over the next few years, he's going to have a fantastic career and he's going to play many games for Australia. So why wouldn't you take him now? Not just on the future, but he could do something in a game. Put him on for 10, 15 minutes. He'll take people on and create something. He doesn't care, like I said, who he's playing against. For me, I'd have him there like a rusted on, no question.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. I wasn't particularly sold on him. And I know he got the move and that can kind of lead a lot into people. You go, well, he has to be there. He's just moved to Newcastle. But look, it's a huge thing. Like I said, he's not starting for the Mariners yet. So we're not talking about him starting games.
I think
for
that's
Australia.
The most minutes in a single match he's played, isn't it? 45 minutes. He's never come on at half time even in a match. So that was the first big test.
You take him on. And like I said, that partnership is going to work because Cummings has to be there. You know, and 4 goals in the second half. They had 2 goals disallowed as well. It feels like Cummings is getting more goals disallowed every week than he is scoring. But he's still putting them away. And like I said, Garang, he makes such a difference when he comes on. That pace is something that isn't there. I'm with you on that. Martin Boyle's starting for me. And I'll always back Borrello. And I messaged you that after the game. You know, I'd take him straight away. I'd take him. But Kowal, for sure, there was part of me that thinks, I don't know if Arnie sold on him. But if he keeps doing this every week, well, I mean, that's all you can do.
If he hadn't done what he did when he came on for the Socceroos and sort of had that electric, and he hadn't done what he'd done against Barcelona for the All-Stars, see, they're the things that are different. And, you know, people might say, oh, the All-Stars against Barcelona, they turned up and they're just going through the motions. He turned
it doesn't
it
matter.
On.
He has an opportunity and he sees it. And that's the thing. It's a good point because I also am skeptical. I'm a big fan of experience. Particularly if you're going to World Cup, I think having been there before is a great thing. And I always, my natural reaction is just, but he still hasn't started a match.
Yeah.
He still hasn't started a match. He hasn't, you know, is he one of the 26 best players? And then every opportunity he gets, he does something spectacular. Where you just think, oh, he's done it again.
Well,
He's
not going to start. For me, he's in the squad as a player that Arnie can look down the line. We're 1-0 down or 1-1 and look down the line and go, who's going to turn someone in inside out and score a goal or create a chance? Mate, go on. You got no fear. Go and do it.
Yeah, that's the huge part. And there's no way you pick a squad where everyone has the same attributes.
Correct.
And no one has the speed that Kowal has. So you take him, use him for 5 minutes, 10 minutes. Don't use him at all. But the fact that you know you have that arsenal on the bench, that's why Walcott went.
Yeah.
I'm not saying they're the same player, but I mean, he's fast.
There was another example back in USA 94 when a young Brazilian kid with braces who'd never kicked a ball before sat every single match on the bench as Brazil went and won the World Cup. I think his name was... anyone?
R7, wasn't it? The Ronaldo. The only Ronaldo.
Exactly.
Yeah,
R9. Yeah. R9. Yeah, absolutely. R7. R7. That's CR7.
Yeah, no.
He gets his Ronaldo.
He's not even the best Ronaldo.
Speaking of comebacks, the Mariners, a 23-minute, 4-goal comeback. There was also a comeback for the Premiers, Melbourne City, who a remontada, rather, against them from the Knicks. City were on their way. Speaking of right-wingers, Marco Tilio earning the penalty and then scoring his first goal of the season as well. We're talking about seizing opportunities at the moment. But then just when it looked as though, I mean, we've seen this before. We've seen City race into a lead when it looked like there could be no way back.
Well, I'm going to kill Simon Hill here because I was calling the other game and I walked out down the tunnel and he was in the other studio and I looked in and saw 2-0 and he gave me the old game over gesture. I was driving the car home and I was just dinging on my phone, goal, goal. I got home and messaged him, game over, ? But look, this is, for me, Ulfi Talay is kind of, this is how his teams are set up. They're hardworking. The team comes first. They never give in. They constantly keep coming.
How good is that finish? Can you just talk, as a striker, talk me through that finish?
I actually had to watch that
awesome.
A couple of times
exactly,
to realise,
gee, just
he took
good.
That really so yeah. quick. And the reason he took it so quickly, the fact that he took it so quickly was the reason that the keeper just had nothing.
Didn't
because
he couldn't dive.
We were all waiting for him to take another step, but it was touch finish and it was done. And it was fantastic finish. It was good to see across the
Romario-esque.
Yes, it was actually.
Good.
It was great to see him come back into references. It though, because again, like a lot of the talk is that City just turned off, and to a degree they might have. They had enough chances to finish it, but Knicks are always in a game. It was the same when they played who did he play? Newcastle Jets the other week. Once they got a goal in, the confidence there, they're making stuff happen. It's just, and in this league, you're seeing it. If people don't take their chances,
and they also led against. They also led against the Mariners and Adelaide in their first game, where they conceded that late equaliser as well. So I think they're still looking for their first win.
I don't think it's
you know
far away
three draws and a loss.
It's a pretty much a Wellington Phoenix thing, isn't it? The start of the season, we don't win the first five games or get a win in the first five, we'll come racing and charging everyone down at the end. So let's see if they can do it again.
Now, I've just been highlighting a couple of great old names of old Brazilian strikers. Let's turn back the football clock to 1991-92 on Tristan McManus there. What is that? Where did it come from? Where did you find it?
Well, I got this off my dad's friend because this was the year that I got into football. It was 91-92. It was the last year of the old First Division. Leeds United's greatest team ever. Ever. Probably the best team that ever played football, I'd say.
Australian left back, no?
Yeah, Tony DiRigo. was in there. It was, we had John Lukic in goal, Mel Stirling, Chris Fairclough, Chris White, Tony DiRigo, the best midfield of all time. Gary McAllister, Gordon Strachan, Gary Speed, David Batty. And up front, Lee Chapman, Rod Wallace. We had Cantona for a while, got rid of him.
Yeah.
I don't know what happened to him.
Went on to nothing.
Yeah. Foreign Rowley there, back in the day as well. fantastic team. And like I said, that was the year that I get into football.
Yeah.
And they were just an unbelievable team.
Well, it was
the
resurgence of Leeds, wasn't it? Because they had a great team there for a spell. Obviously, they went on to have the great Australian connection
as well
before they overspent and did the English
just a little
Premier
bit.
League.
Well, that's, because they just won the second division. Howard Wilkinson came in, Vinnie Jones came in, Chris Kamara, all these players. And then, I mean, he's arguably one of our greatest managers ever, Howard Wilkinson, and he doesn't get the credit that he deserves, I think. But Leeds were a super team back then. They were unbelievable, really great. And like I said, I got into football that year. I fell in love with this team. Gary Speed, God rest his soul, but he was one of the best midfielders there ever was.
Yeah. Fantastic, the Welshman.
Not so good now, though, are they?
Leeds, what are you talking about? We just smashed Liverpool at the weekend. Mm. Everyone got quiet, didn't they? Everyone got really quiet at the weekend, all these Liverpool fans. Beat Napoli, be whoever you want to. You can't beat Leeds.
Yeah. Macca.
Yes.
Your T-shirt.
Oh, my T-shirt today is a little Alan Partridge segment.
I thought that was you. I just get carried away with himself. I didn't want to say it, and I was like...
Now, I just like Alan Partridge, and it's a... A nice little snippet from one of his shows. It's quite funny.
It was brilliant. Good
anyway,
stuff.
Go Google it.
What about yourself there before you move on?
Yeah.
Well, we've got to move on. No, this is a classic footballer's T-shirt from France. It says, I was going to sign pro, but I did my knee.
Oh, me too.
And so,
never, ever heard that in my life, ever. About a million times.
Exactly. So good they put it on a T-shirt and I bought it. So, the other results from the weekend in the A-League men's competition. Western Sydney Wanderers still going. They got up over the Jets 2-0. The Wanderers are undefeated for the Jets. It was their first loss. They still have a game in hand. Amalfitano and Borrello, the scorers there. Brisbane and victory 0-0. Three draws and a loss for Brisbane. Three games without a win now for Melbourne victory. And no goals in their last three, as we mentioned. MacArthur, 3-2 loss to Sydney. That was a bit of a cracker and a first loss for MacArthur, a controversial one as well. And then in the final match of the round, Adelaide got up over Perth despite an absolute cracker from Gio Colli, and it was Adelaide's first win of the season as well. Well, I think that's just about it for today's show. Oh no, we're going to talk red cards and my notes for talking referees is just written on this bit of paper. Ask Macca. So here we go. Daniel McBreen.
We haven't got enough time.
We've had some... let me set the scene before we go for it. So we've had a lot of red cards. We've had a lot of controversy. We've had VAR getting involved. There's plenty to unpack. There was a meeting yesterday where the head of the referees, Nathan McGill, spoke to the media. He was on Simon Hill's radio show last night as well, talking about a few of the decisions. We've seen decisions overturned. We've seen others upheld. Let's ask Macca. Macca, what do you make about the refereeing at the moment? Because the referees are justifying certain positions and saying, look, this one is a call that was made and we're standing by it. Others, like the Ibasuki, are being rescinded.
Yep.
I thought Macca was on the call yesterday with the referees, and the buzzword that came out of it for me was threshold. And this is an interesting one, because there are thresholds for challenges at various degrees of intensity.
Yep.
And it's where you place the threshold. And Macca, where is this threshold?
Well, at the moment, it's below the floor. we've had 9 cards in 23 games at the start of the season. That's since 1977, since the Australian National League started. That's a record. We've never had so many red cards after 23 games. So obviously something's going on. Now, look, there's always rules that come in, and every year there's these new mandates on what we're going to do. And we sort of, it seems we go through the first 4 or 5 rounds every year and we have these discussions, and then it mellows down. But so far, the threshold for VAR intervention and red cards seems to be so low that there's nowhere to go. Okay, and I think I'm getting messages from coaches, players, fans, all across the board saying, what is going on? And, you know, we're seeing decisions that come through where they're football fouls. Not every, it's a football sport, right? It's a contact sport, sorry, football. And not every contact is a foul. And players know that you're sometimes going to go in and you're going to crash bodies together, go down, and you get up and get on with it, because that's the nature of the sport. Otherwise, let's get the wing defense bibs out, and every time someone touches each other, we'll say contact, wing defense, here's a free kick. Mm. It's not that. And there's football fouls going on that everybody seems to go, yeah, that's a foul, that's a yellow card, let's get on with it, in the respect that we want to go and watch a spectacle of the game. We'd rather have 11v11 all the time, but we're jumping straight to, let's have another look at that, that could be a red. And then when everybody is incredulous, when it becomes a red card. So I think the threshold needs to be just lifted a little bit higher and thinking, okay, it's a contact sport. Yes, I'm not talking about broken leg tackles, yeah, high through the knee, or that. We know that's what we're not wanting in the game. But we're talking about decisions that are very grey area red cards, and we're immediately jumping to the red card. So we saw Ibasuki, where we all saw that got rescinded. Okay, this is Taras Gomulka earlier in the season. Now, on the tour yesterday, they said they thought that this fell below the threshold of a straight red card. You can see no contact with the studs. It's more shin on shin as he goes across. No one really complains, and then all of a sudden it's a red. It's disbelief. And this is happening, seems, time and time and time again. This is the Ibasuki one. This one was rescinded. Okay, fair play. But he clears the ball there. He actually tries to pull his feet back away from the challenge. To me, Caceres is late in the challenge.
Yeah.
So Caceres is... the onus of him is to get out the way as well, because there's nothing in that. Now, this one was actually told to us this was allowed to play on. Both players touch the ball. Players coming at different directions to each other, clatter into each other, and actually was play on. There wasn't a free kick given. Now, I was told that one was supposed to be for stopping a goal-scoring opportunity. Meanwhile, there was defenders everywhere. Again, no one can understand this. At first look, second look, third look, no one can understand why that is a Sydney free kick. We all penalty. We all thought that it would be overturned. VAR doesn't overturn it. Okay. Now we can see here again. Ball goes through. Referees have justified that's a last man challenge. That he is definitely going to get a shot away. I would say that's a grey area. Is he going to get a shot away? Is the defender still close enough? It's a grey area. Why are we always going to, well, it seems to, go to the error of, red card. Now, I think we spoke about this one before. This is the encroachment within the wall. Now, does the encroachment on the wall affect anything from the defender and the goalkeeper there? In my opinion, no. And I know to the letter of the law, he said, don't go within the wall. He runs behind the wall. But there's got to be some discretion and common sense on, is that affecting the play? Would that have gone, I just don't think there's enough discretion on the threshold of, has that affected, what is happening in the game?
Tristan, we've been watching football all our lives. We have things that and the game has evolved. The intensity has evolved a lot from the old days when the goalkeeper could pick up the ball, when you saw players walking around and, rolling the ball out. And the game has changed massively in 30 years. But the rules are the rules, aren't they? You have to uphold the rules. At what point and how much discretion, Macca's calling for discretion and common sense, how much can you say, but look, we've seen it so many times before, but if you've played the game, you know that's not a foul. But it's in the rules.
You want a direct comparison.
Direct comparison.
I don't like doing this because I don't like to talk about other leagues. Premier League, Clear mandate this year, let the game flow. Let's not go overboard with the fouling. Mm. They've had 8 red cards in 13 or 14 rounds of cards. So it's 130, 140 games. It's the most watched league in the world because it's free-flowing going. Now, has the game descended into anarchy and broken legs every time because there's robust tackles? Mm. No. Players don't go down now because they know if it's a soft challenge and I go down, they're not going to give me a foul. So they go in and have a proper football challenge. We're going the other way. We're over-sanitising the game.
Yeah. It's all subjective, and I think that's people's frustration with the VAR as well, because the VAR was supposed to come in to eliminate that. So if it's not doing that, what's the point of it? Like, you know, and we're all going to have... I'm an armchair fan, so my opinion of something's going to be very different to your own when it comes to it. And even that one for Weston, the red card, I can see that. I can see it justified, because it might not be right or wrong, but you kind of go, right, well, take the card, take the foul. And I think if he had tripped them, he probably would have got the red and got one ban. But I think the fact that it was on a calf... And granted, we said that, Kowal, you just get up and you got on with it. But a 34-year-old might not have got up. And so, and then we'll be complaining about not consistency when it comes true. So it's too subjective. So whether it's right or whether it's wrong, if we're going to use VAR, we have to use it right. Mm-hmm. And they use it in rugby. And then you go, right, well, then we accept it because you can hear everything that they're saying. It's black and white, and we get on with it. But you might as well just go back to kind of go, right, well, make your mind up and we'll accept it. Because you can accept that human error. You can't accept it with VAR there.
Well, this is... I think that's a very good point, but that's also part of the history of football, isn't it? And we love talking about the day we was robbed and the day, you know, we could have. And I mean, obviously, England should never have won the World Cup. I think we all agree with that in 1966. The ball never crossed the line.
And your boy Henri as well, with his handball putting us out of the World
Exactly.
Cup.
Back in, yeah, exactly. William Gallas scored, I think, from Henri's handball.
But you go to VAR as well, and you go back to, okay, we're looking now at replaying an incident that took 3 seconds at full pace. And we're narrowing down to 1 second in slow motion and going, oh, yeah, it always looks worse. Why do we use slow motion in all of our promotions and stuff? Because it's dramatic. It looks better. Everything. So we're taking it all out of context. If you need to watch something in slow motion 4 or 5 times, just go back to the decision and get on with it.
Is it not the fact that there's just so much money in football now and that the decisions of the referee can mean the difference between...
The
if you're talking about a promotion...
Evil. It's the root of all evil, money.
But there is a lot riding on referees' decisions. In the Champions League, I mean, and not to disrespect a last generation, but, you know, a game that was filmed by 3 cameras when the referee would call offside, and you could never really tell if it was offside or not from the TV cameras anyway. Now you can, and now it's dissected by this football industry to the minutest of details. And that's why people don't accept it. If you're playing a promotion playoff game and the decision goes against you, you can say, oh, you know, remember when we could have got promoted back in 2019? It's not that anymore. It's now, that was the end of us. We didn't get all that money. We our new stadium never got built. The club goes down. We've got English clubs folding at the moment.
But
big old clubs folding.
Like Tristan said, VAR was supposed to take this argument out of the game. And here we are. They're jumping in even more, it seems, when everyone seems happy with the decision. They're jumping in over the top.
Yeah.
Stay out of it.
Well, is this not just a generational thing then, Macca? Are we just not old fogies now?
What's
that rock and roll music you listen to?
But we never talk about the finances of the game that we love afterwards. We just talk about, like you said, when we got stitched or when we didn't.
Yeah. Yeah,
and we can accept that because we know we're going to get another even chance to do it next week. Now you're listening to someone who might not be even at the game. Yeah. Making a decision and making 2 referees question the decisions because someone's going to make it anyway because the referees decided something, the person in VAR has decided something, and then someone in a box somewhere has told them what to say. I mean, for want of a better word, simplifying that somewhere. Yeah. But you know what I mean? That's what it is. You won't be happy
with
it.
Well, we're just taking the responsibility away from the referee and giving it to somebody else.
It's another person making a different decision.
Room.
That's not our beautiful game.
No. Move on to the more beautiful parts of the game.
Well, more beautiful parts we'll be chatting still to come. But we do have a Twitter poll on the Twitter handle at ParamountPlusAU. Who gets you excited the most out of these A-League men's players? Nani, Garang Kuol, Joe Lolly. And there's one for you in there, Tristan McManus.
How many times have you voted on me?
A million times. I'll tell you why, all right? Because the very first game I'd done was Western Sydney Wanderers and Perth. And I said it before, it wasn't a great game. But what happened was Barella went, he ran down the ring, he got taken clean out. Mm-hmm. And he rolled, and without breaking stride, he got up and he ran after the ball again. That's what I want to see. And that's what I want to see in my team. I want to see someone who's going to run till the end. And that's exactly what Wanderers need. I love Brandon Borrello. I'll say right now, he'll be the first name on the plane.
Macca, anyone not on that on that
I'm excited by a lot of players because that's...
Where are the goalkeepers that we get excited by? Can you get excited by a big central defender?
Yeah. Plenty of times. Yeah. Look, we play... Our boys in the A-League out there are playing some fantastic football, which breaks my heart while we just sat there and had that little rant about that stuff. Because we should be talking about... There's been some fantastic games all around.
But on the weekend, they were classic games. Yeah. I think 20 goals scored in 6 games. Yeah. If you take out the 0-0, which you can't do, but if you take out the 0-0 between Victory and Brisbane, that's 4 goals a game.
Yeah.
And they're cracking games of coming from behind, of there is controversy for the neutral observer. If you're watching a game where there's a bit of controversy and a bit of excitement, bring it on. We're going to a quick break, but we will be back. We've got Matt Crowell, the former Wrexham player and former Central Coast Mariner, coming on for a chat about the FA Cup, because the FA Cup kicks off this weekend and you can catch all of it on Paramount Plus. It's back, the English FA Cup, the romance, the magic of the cup, and it's all back on Paramount Plus. Round one proper of football's oldest competition starting this weekend on Paramount Plus in the middle of the night. Gentlemen, the FA Cup, it's some of our great childhood memories, I guess, for all of us here in Australia, watching it on, you know, in the middle of the night on the ABC back in the 1980s when Craig Johnson was scoring it in the final. I mean, incredible moments for Australian football fans, Macca.
Yeah, well, that's one of my first memories of watching English football is the 86 FA Cup final. My dad was actually an Everton supporter and flew over there. And I asked my mum, who are we supporting? And to wind him up, we said, we're going for Liverpool because of Craig Johnson. He's Australian.
So this runs in the family, this trait, Macca, of winding people up.
Yeah, it does, actually. Yeah. My mum and dad were quite good at it, so I've got both their genes. And I supported Liverpool ever since because, obviously, Craig Johnson did so well in that game. Yeah. And my dad brought me home against his best wishes at Liverpool strip because he said, if supporting an Aussie, I'll go with you. And, I've been madly in love with the game ever since.
You didn't switch the leads when we had about 19 Australian players there?
No, it was all too embedded then. Oh, I did actually have a trial at Leeds.
Did you?
Yeah, while Harry Kewell was there. Wow. Obviously, it was too...
Didn't go well, huh?
I wasn't very good.
Did Liverpool play the weekend?
Yeah, they did actually, yeah. No, they didn't play, they turned up.
They turned up. Oh, did they?
FA Cup for you, Tristan.
Oh, I love it. I absolutely love it. Yeah. I don't really have any kind of outstanding memories from the FA Cup. I just love cup competitions. I mean, obviously we all love the league, but I mean, we're all about the underdog, aren't we, and everything that happens. And I love these early rounds because, well, I mean, you get to know a little bit about the teams as well that are coming through. And then just the passion that you sometimes lose with the top divisions. You know, you kind of see these guys, they're breaking themselves just to play football because it's everyone's dream, like, you know?
There's nothing better than seeing a lower league team knock over one of the big boys, is there? Oh, let's 100%. Be honest, unless it's yours.
Well, we had it in the Australian Cup this year, didn't we? I mean, we lived the beauty of a cup competition firsthand this year with Oakley Cannons and Sydney United going all the way to the final as well. Well, it all kicks off this weekend, round one proper of the FA Cup, and it kicks off with Hereford versus Portsmouth on Saturday morning at 6:45, one of the main games, Wrexham versus Oldham Athletic on Sunday night at 11:20, all that is Australian Eastern Daylight Saving Time. And I'm happy to say that we're joined by Matt Crowell, who of course spent 5 years at Wrexham AFC, the Welshman, but also one season on the Central Coast with the Central Coast Mariners. Matt, does the FA Cup still get you up in the middle of the night to tune in?
Yeah, for sure. Obviously, it's got great history, the FA Cup. I didn't personally have a great run in it myself when I was lucky enough to play in it. But for sure, it's a huge competition worldwide. It's an exciting time, especially back home when the FA Cup comes around, for sure.
Matty, we've all been buzzing off Welcome to Wrexham. It's a fantastic show. What's your own thoughts on these Hollywood superstars, Ryan Reynolds and Rob McElhenney, taking over your club?
Well, obviously, it's pretty special. I've still got friends in the town. It's gone completely crazy at the minute back home. I think it's been superb. you know, it is a football town. They're very passionate. They've had a lot of trouble off field for a while now. So it's, I think it's nice that they've got a little bit of Hollywood stars in there to put a bit of spotlight back on the town. And no, it's exciting for sure. Really happy for them.
Crowley, mate, obviously you said there it's so passionate about the town and how much the club has influences that. What's it like playing there but also living in the town, mate?
Well, it's not as good when you lose, that's for sure, do you know what I mean? And it's definitely changed since I was there. I was there, obviously, if you've seen the doco series, I was actually there when all that off-field trouble was going on with the old chairman and going into administration and all that. So I was actually there then. I remember getting paid sometimes in a brown envelope. Nothing probably what it's like now, but, and that was in League One as well at the time. So, you know, it's a while back, but it, you know, like I said, it's a really exciting time for everyone involved with Wrexham. There's a lot of good people there. If you watch the doco series, there's a lot of faces that are still there from when I was there. So it's pretty cool to see all those people enjoying it right now. So yes, it's good.
Plenty of familiar faces then at the club that you remember, Matt. But what about the current squad? Do you think they're good enough to do one better than last year and actually get that promotion?
Yeah, I think looking at this side right now, it's pretty strong for a National League side. Obviously, money helps. They've managed to get some really good players in, especially the front two in that Ollie Palmer and Paul Mullen. Like, obviously, Mullen's an exceptional talent for that level. We've always been quite fortunate to have good strikers, really. Just going back to when Lee Trundle was there, you might not know Lee Trundle, but he was a similar type of makeup of a Paul Mullen, a Liverpool lad, a Scouser. Obviously, close connections with Wrexham and Liverpool not being too far away. So, no, I think they've definitely got a really good squad. They've got a really good young Wrexham lad playing in the heart of midfield for them, and Jordan Davis, he looks like a really good football player. I'm desperate for them to get the streaming rights so I could buy the stream so I can watch it over here. That's what I'm waiting for. But no, I definitely think they got a good squad. They've got an experienced manager. He's been successful. But like I said when we were chatting a little bit earlier, there's always like one or two teams that are pretty strong, and Knox County I've got a good team as well. Obviously, Nottingham Forest have just been promoted, so it's a good buzz in football around that town as well. So I think they're going to be in a fight for the top spot, but fingers crossed they can get it done. And yeah, I think who knows what can happen once you get promoted, and you know, crazier things have happened, haven't they? Do you know what I mean? I was at Swansea and they ended up going all the way through to the Premier League. So no, fingers crossed.
You've got Oldham coming up this weekend in the Cup. You know them from the league. Obviously, the league table suggests that you could put them away, probably. Do you reckon Wrexham can go on a Cup run this year?
Yeah, I think a Cup run is the exciting one for them right now. Again, they've got a squad that's quite comfortably could compete at Football League 2 and League 1. I don't think anyone could really argue with that. So I think they could have a good cup run. Wrexham have had some good upsets over the years. I remember the old Mickey Thomas free kick that knocked Arsenal out in the 90s when there was a young David Seaman in goals there. So, like, yeah, I think with the excitement with the football club at the minute, I think sometimes these things take control of themselves and, like, the story keeps writing itself, and they could have a bit of a good run, which would be pretty cool. I could imagine Ryan Reynolds tuning up to all them for sure.
Righto, we know you're going to be watching Wrexham and following them, mate. What other fixtures are going to catch your eye?
I did see, like I always take a following for all the Welsh sites, and Newport County have obviously got a good tie there. There's a few, like I think everyone likes the underdog, and there's some lower league clubs that have made it through. I think Charlton are playing someone, I can't remember on top of my head who is. That's, you know, that's an exciting tie for the team who are playing them. It's at Charlton. So, you know, the FA Cup, you know, brings moments like that. So, yeah, I'd love to see all the Welsh sides do well, to be fair. So hopefully Wrexham and Newport County can go through.
Thanks, Matt. Charlton are playing Colville Town. sounds like a cracker. Thanks, mate. Thanks for coming on.
No props, mate. Anytime. Thanks for having us on.
There will be plenty of matches over the weekend. Saturday, Sunday, Monday, and even Tuesday morning, the final match. We're bringing you Bracknell Town versus Ipswich Town. So a big club in action there as well. That's about it for us. Do we have any other controversial things we want to talk about anymore?
Just let's see what we're going to see this week. The action.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah. That's it, mate. It's going to be good.
All right, so coming up, round five of the A-League men's season, Friday night, Melbourne Victory versus the Jets. The Victory, maybe with Bruno Fornaroli up front against the Jets, looking to end that run of three games without a goal. City take on Perth on Saturday afternoon. The 10 bold game, Western Sydney Wanderers versus the Central Coast Mariners at 7:45 Eastern time on Saturday night at CommBank. The Phoenix take on MacArthur on Sunday in Wellington. That's a 1 p.m. kickoff time in Sydney, Australia. Brisbane Roar against Sydney FC. That one's on bold as well. Brisbane looking to bounce back against a Sydney side who are undefeated in their last three and on the charge, sitting third on the table. And then the final match of the round, Sunday afternoon, 5 p.m. Eastern time. Western United taking on Adelaide United. Plenty of storylines in there as well. Tristan, what takes your fancy?
Oh, there's a couple of games there. Barilla Mariners, that's not a legal game. No, but really, to be honest with you, I'm looking forward to most Western playing Adelaide on the Sunday. I love Adelaide. I'd never go against them. But Western, I think last week was the first time we kind of saw the Western of old. I'd like to see them do well, you know. But yeah, Adelaide, I just love Adelaide. Craigie Goodwin as well. So it's going to be a big game.
You went to Adelaide to see a game, did you, or not yet?
I went last season. I haven't been to the new Coopers yet.
Yeah. Because I remember last season you were travelling around the country, weren't you? Trying to, you know, thinking which teams you like, and you end up loving all of them.
I did. Well, that's the thing. I think that's what's great when you don't have a dog in the fight. You know, you can appreciate it. I love this league. It's so easy. Like, obviously, I get up in the middle of the night and watch Leeds all the time. Mm-hmm. There's no comparison with these leagues. And I get sick of hearing people trying to compare them. Yeah. The league that we have here is perfect. Mm-hmm. I absolutely love it. There's something to love about all the teams. Yeah. And I really do. And you know, you can never really fully back one team because the other one has so much to enjoy about them as well. I hope Western get back to what we saw last year. Hopefully not at the expense of Adelaide. But I'm looking forward to that one as well. And I just have a feeling about Brisbane Roar and Sydney this weekend as well.
You think they're going to win?
I know, I always do that. Yeah, it's just going to win one of those games. But it could happen.
Sydney fans are going to start coming for you, mate. They really will, losing.
Do you know, Macca? I keep taking all the merch from Sydney as well. Sorry, guys.
Tristan has spoken about all six games and all 12 potential winners this weekend. What about you?
Look, I think Western Sydney look pretty sharp this season, and I think they've done some really good ticket deals as well. I saw with them to try and get people back to their stadium, and I think they get success. The Mariners riding high after that. I think it'll be a great game, and hopefully the crowd comes with those cheap tickets as well, which is a great, I think that's fantastic. That's what they need to do to help get the fans back as well. So I'm looking forward to that one.
I'm doing that game. That's all I didn't say, that one. Can't wait for it.
The football has been brilliant so far this season. There have been some super interesting, entertaining matches as well. There's no doubt that's going to continue as well this weekend. Finally then, just before we go, Macca, just while you were talking there, I noticed something growing on your upper lip.
Yes.
Now, it's only the second of the month. Mm. That's this is going to be a jungle by the end of the month. What's that all about?
As I've got older, it started to grow, obviously, doing Movember. I've done it a few times before, but something that's very special to my heart. I've lost three people I know in the last 18 months for suicide, and that's one of the causes that it goes to. So if anyone out there wants to get involved, you can go to Movember.com or sponsor. Get on there and do that and helps out. It all goes to great causes. Very popular.
Fantastic. All for a good cause. Thank you, Macca. Thank you, Tristan, for joining us. Thank you for joining us at home. And we'll see you again next week for more Round Ball Rules. Bye-bye. Yep.